In today's video, I'll show you how I solved a persistent chassis battery discharge issue in my 2020 Thor 26HE. Basically, the chassis battery is constantly discharging itself, even when plugged into shore power. By the time I'm moving to my next campsite, the chassis or engine battery doesn't have enough juice to turn the motor over, and I have to resort to using the emergency start button, which shunts power from the house battery. Because of how differently RVs can be built, even within the same manufacturer, your mileage may vary when it comes to my solution, but hopefully it'll set you up in the right direction. The problem, as it turned out, is in fact twofold, both why the battery was discharging, but also why it was discharging while on shore power. After poking around on some forums about this problem, I came upon the BIM as the suspect. The BIM, or Battery Isolation Manager, is a device that allows one battery to charge another, given that one of them is actively being charged. So the first thing I did was I looked under the hood and studied what I had, which was the BIM, as well as a contactor relay from Trombetta. I left a bit confused, because for the most part it all seemed to work. I could definitely flip the emergency switch and hear the contactor close the relay, and while driving I could see that the voltage on my house battery was about 13.7 volts, so the chassis was definitely charging the house battery while driving. I emailed Thor to get some answers, because it wasn't clear to me how the chassis battery was supposed to get charged. My question to them was whether or not there existed a device to charge the house battery, and if there was, how could I test it? The conversation basically went like this, and I'm paraphrasing a bit. "Hi, my chassis battery is discharging even while I'm on shore power. Do you have any ideas why this might be?"
"The chassis battery should charge while on shore power. Coach would need to be plugged into an actual 30 amp shore. Check your battery."
"I am always plugged into 30 amps and it's still discharging. The battery is only 3 years old and holds charge. What device is actually responsible for charging chassis?"
"The chassis battery does not charge on shore power. To charge the chassis battery, you drive it. Shore power will charge the house battery."
"What? You just said shore power does charge battery. I'm confused now."
"Once the house battery is fully charged, it will allow a trickle charge to the chassis, but that by no means will charge the chassis battery."
"Oh, okay. So what device actually does this?"
"The battery isolation manager."
"Great. Is there any way to test if trickle charge is working or not?"
"There is not, as it is not a way to actively charge the coach, but more help maintain the battery life."
It is at this point that I decided to disregard both the forums, as well as Thor, to try to get to the bottom of this. I studied the wiring, wound up creating this schematic, and read the spec sheets for both the Trombetta contactor relay, as well as the IntelliTech BIM. As it turns out, the BIM I have has no so-called trickle charge option. It only has one job. It looks for 13.3 volts or more to come from the ignition wire for more than 9 seconds, which means that the engine is running, and then it sends a signal to close the Trombetta relay so the house battery can charge off of the chassis battery. But it gets even more interesting. I also found that in late 2019, Thor issued this recall for certain 2020 Thor models, which, as I understand it, had to do with loose contacts on the BIM being a potential fire hazard. In this recall, they replaced this single unit BIM 110 from Precision Circuits with a Trombetta contactor paired to an IntelliTech BIM. The old BIM from Precision Circuits, as it turns out, did have the capability to charge both batteries, but the new one from IntelliTech did not. I don't know if this was intentional or an oversight, but if it was an oversight, it's easy to see how they might have replaced the part and not noticed that the chassis battery was draining, because depending on the battery's condition, it can take up to about a week for it to do so. So from here, I was hoping that IntelliTech made a BIM model that could manage charge for both batteries, and sure enough, there was. It's called the IntelliTech BIRD, or Bidirectional Isolator Relay Delay, part number 00-00362-100. I'll put a link to it in the description. Here is the schematic updated to use the BIRD instead of the BIM. Your mileage may vary when it comes to wire colors, but you should be able to figure out which wire goes where by looking in your own RV's engine compartment and just relabeling the schematic. The BIRD does everything the BIM does, but it has this additional pin here that you need to wire directly to the coach or house battery's positive terminal. With this, as long as the house battery is above 13.1 volts for about 2.5 minutes, as it would be if you were plugged into shore power, it'll send a signal to close the trombetta relay, and now your house battery is charging your chassis battery. To install it, start by disconnecting both the house and chassis batteries. Remove the 3 5/16-inch bolts holding the coolant overflow reservoir, then set it aside to reveal the BIM. No need to disconnect any of the coolant hoses. As an aside, the system has two fuses here and here. It's worth double-checking these fuses if your system wasn't functioning at all. In my RV, the blue wire comes from the yellow ignition wire and goes directly into the IntelliTech, and again, your wire colors may be different. Cut this blue wire somewhere close to the IntelliTech. Undo the nut on the trombetta contactor to free the black ground wire off of the IntelliTech. Then do the same for the red wire. The IntelliTech can now be removed, but I chose to keep it where it was as a spare unit and just capped off the wires with some electrical tape. For the new IntelliTech bird unit, a few wires will have to be made. All the wires I have here are 16 gauge. Crimp a female spade connector on the blue ignition wire. Make a 24 or so inch black ground wire with a female spade on one end, and a quarter inch ring terminal on the other, then do the same for a red wire that we'll use for the relay. The last wire we'll make will also be 24 inches, have a female spade on one end, and a larger 5/16 inch ring terminal on the other end. This will be the coach battery wire. When I get the chance, I'll be putting an inline 10 amp fuse on this wire to protect the bird. You can now wire it all up. Use the black wire from the bird ground terminal to the ground terminal on the trombetta, the red wire with small ring terminal from the bird relay terminal to the trombetta relay terminal, the blue ignition wire to the ignition terminal to the bird, and finally, the red wire with large terminal ring to the house battery terminal on the trombetta, which is here, but again, it may be different on your RV. There's plenty of space further down the wheel well to mount the bird, and I chose to just use adhesive with a really strong Velcro, though I'll probably attach it more securely with bolts or fastener clips at some point. At this point, you can reconnect the batteries to test if this thing works. Within 2.5 minutes, so long as you're connected to shore power or running the engine, you should hear an audible click from the trombetta. Likewise, you should see the voltage across the chassis battery start to increase on account of being charged. Initially, this didn't actually work for me, and it turned out to be a bad bird, which I bought as a quote-unquote used like new unit. Go figure. From here, as long as the RV was plugged in, the issue was gone. But since I wanted the issue to go away altogether, I went ahead and figured out what was causing the battery drain in the first place. After measuring the current in the fuse box by unplugging countless fuses and coming up with no clues, I zeroed in on the Xera audio receiver. I had a suspicion about it being a culprit because despite the fact that the ignition was off, I could still turn it on. I assumed the intent was to be able to use it even when the engine isn't running, which makes sense. I'm briefly going to skip to the end here, because I was only able to conduct the current draw test with the Xera out of the dash. Turns out, it draws a constant 0.28 amps even when off, which is definitely sufficient to fully drain the battery within a couple of days. So to fix this, I decided to do two things. First, I rewired it so that it draws power off of the house battery instead of the chassis battery. To me, I'd rather have a discharged house battery than a chassis battery because if I'm camping, I'm on shore power anyhow, so the house battery won't get discharged, but it's not a good situation if I can't start the RV. Because of this drain issue, I had to replace the chassis battery, which could not hold a charge anymore. The second thing I did was I wired an on-off switch to the power wire going to the Xera. This way, should I ever need to store the RV, I could just flip the switch and not really have to worry about the battery discharging in a matter of days. With that, let's start on the second half of the project, which is unfortunately considerably hairier than installing the bird. Again, you'll want to disconnect both batteries. In my Ford E350, which the RV is based on, the dash comes off by just pulling on it with your hands. But don't pull it off completely, because all the connectors are still attached to your controls. I decided not to remove the dash because there seemed to be some vacuum lines connected to the HVAC controls, and I didn't want to risk messing that up somehow. That makes the job considerably more difficult, but not impossible. The only two harnesses I did disconnect went to the cigarette lighter outlets, and this created more slack in the dash. it's a good idea to pull the volume knob off first, because it'll create more maneuvering space. Remove the bezel surrounding the Xera, which takes a good amount of prying and patience. Behind the removed bezel, there should be a 7mm bolt on each corner holding the Xera in place, so remove those. I did this by using a wrench and sliding it in behind the dash initially to break them loose, then just using the jaw end of the wrench to unscrew the bolt the rest of the way. You can now slide the Xera out a bit. There is a mounting bracket on each side preventing the Xera from sliding out all the way. I slid the Xera out of the opening at an angle to access the single screw holding the mounting bracket in place, and repeated this on the other side. Now the Xera can be slid out all the way. According to the manual, there are two 12-volt power wires going directly to the Xera. One is red, or the ignition ACC wire, and the other is yellow, or the memory / battery wire. Frankly, I have no idea what the function of the red wire is, because it had a blown inline fuse, and upon replacing it, it didn't seem to affect the behavior of the Xera at all. In fact, I couldn't power the Xera on at all once I cut the yellow wire, even with my key in the ignition and seeing 12 volts on the red wire. Either way, the yellow wire seems to be the right wire to put a switch on. At this point, I routed a 16-gauge wire to the Trombetta. I figured I could tap directly off of the house battery from there. To do this, I tugged on the lower half of the dash beneath the steering wheel and found the wire sheath for the emergency start-stop button. I used this because the sheath goes directly to the Trombetta and will allow for a clean installation without any exposed wires. In order to put the wire inside the sheath and through the firewall, I pulled a bit of the sheath out through the firewall in the engine bay. Then I put the 16-gauge wire into the sheath, as close to the firewall as possible, and then shoved it in. I then went back inside the cab and pulled the sheath back in a little, which delivered with it the red wire. I then routed it part way up the sheath to the dash, then jumped over to a different cable sheath, which conveniently led right to the Xera. If you don't have it, just route it along some wires and use some zip ties along the way to secure it down. Next, I routed it through the sheath in the engine bay, then soldered an inline fuse to this same wire, and crimped and soldered a 5/16-inch ring terminal to the end of it. Now it was time to find a place for the on-off switch. Initially, I drilled a hole here by the HVAC, but in retrospect, it wasn't a very good place and didn't have enough space for the switch behind it. Instead, I took this blank plug and carved it using a combination of wire cutters, sharp knife, and toenail clippers until I created a cradle for the switch to go behind it. The blank plug is a good place for this because there's a cavity in the chassis behind it where the wires and protruding switch can go. Next, I undid the wire splice for the yellow wire, which comes from the Ford factory harness. The supply wire I just taped off and tucked away, remember, this has 12 volts going to it somewhere from the battery, so make sure there's no way it can short out. Tape it up, do whatever it takes. Then, I made two identical 16-gauge wires with small ring terminals for the switch, secured them to the screw terminals, and wrapped it all in electrical tape for good measure. Using these Wago 221 lever connectors, I joined the red wire from the switch with the red wire I pulled from the battery, and other red wire from the switch with the yellow wire from the Xera, and taped them off for good measure. At this point, it's a good idea to test everything. So back at the Trombetta, I undid the half-inch nut where the house wire goes, and connected the ring terminal to the same lug. If you haven't done so already, put a 10-amp fuse into the inline fuse holder at this time. Reconnect the batteries and make sure the Xera turns on, and that the switch can turn it off. If everything checks out, then it's time to button everything up. Tuck the cable mesh back in, screw the brackets back in the same way as when they were taken off, reinstall the 7mm bolts, followed by the bezel, which is every bit as hard to put back on as it was to take off, reconnect the cigarette outlet connectors, then snap the dashboard back into place. Don't forget about the volume knob, then put the coolant reservoir back. Finally, it is finished. The chassis battery will no longer drain while on shore power because of the bird, the radio is now on the house battery, and there is now a switch for the radio that can be used when the RV is put into storage. It's still probably a good idea to keep the RV hooked up in storage or at least on a battery tender, but with this, it won't drain nearly as fast. Likewise, if you're boondocking, don't forget to flip the switch off unless you got your generator running or a considerably larger battery bank than what I have. Until next time, thank you for watching.